Hi, everybody. Today on iTalk Movies, we have Jona Xiao. Now, she's talking about her new movie, Gifted, as well as her role coming up in the new Spider-Man Homecoming. So stay tuned.
Welcome to Popcorn Talk, featuring movie discussion, news, and interviews. Popcorn Talk, we talk movies. And now, here's Popcorn Talk's iTalk Movies.
Hey, everybody. It's so good to be back. I am your host, Keetin Marchi, bringing you a special iTalk Movies today with actress Jona Xiao. And I like to say actress and I want to say like activist because you're an actor who helps other actors. And a lot of people, mm-hmm. a lot of actors don't do that because it's a very competitive world. So she's an amazing actress, an amazing human being, and great gamer, you guys. She does some flag football, and I've had a couple game nights with her. But Jona,
those are fun.
Welcome.
Thank you, Keetin. I love that introduction. I hope I can live up to it.
Easily. I need to remind you guys. You guys can all follow me at Keetin Marchi, and obviously you can follow the Popcorn Talk Network at the Popcorn Talk Network. And Jona, where can we follow you on social media?
Sure, it's Jona Xiao, Jona Xiao. So that's for Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all of the above.
Awesome. That's how I am too. So I got Keetin Marchi all across. When you have a unique name, you get really lucky. So let's first talk about, I feel like I know your story. The audience might not know your story, but how did you get into acting? And is this something you've always wanted to do?
I have ever since I was about 12 years old.
Has been in the blood.
Yes. It's been a while. So I was essentially forced to take a drama class. I had to take an arts elective. And so I chose, I ended up taking a drama class. And I ended up being cast in Rappin' Stiltskin, which is the rapping version of Rumpelstiltskin.
Really?
Mm-hmm. It was a comedy. And me rapping is definitely a funny, funny thing indeed.
Do you remember any of it?
I remember loving like every single rehearsal and like that being the highlight of like my day, like every single day in school. And so I love making people laugh and feel, and yeah, that's when I kind of got bit by the acting bug.
Awesome. 12 years old. And now that you've moved to Hollywood, did you come here saying, yes, I'm on the actor's path, I know what to do, like kind of blinders up, or have you kind of moved and grooved in different positions?
Well, when I moved out here, I knew I was going to pursue acting. And at the same time, I knew I was clueless about the business side of the industry because I had made a lot of mistakes. And acting for me for a long time was a very expensive hobby. So I actually explored the worlds of like casting, representation. So I was like figuring out, well, do I want to be an agent? And then, I mean, I love and respect my friends and representation. It's a tough, tough job. And I was like, not for me. So I dabbled in a few different areas of the entertainment business. And then I was like, yep, acting.
Acting.
And
yeah,
back to acting.
I should have just stuck with it. Yep. You'd be an amazing manager, though, I feel like. You'd be amazing. So have you gotten to a point yet in your career? I mean, I feel like I was looking at your IMDb today, and it's kind of amazing how much you've done in kind of the last 2.5 years. Like, mm-hmm. really, like, your credits have been amazing.
Thank you.
Has it kind of hit you yet that you're kind of on hitting that upward trajectory? I don't want to, like, you know, jinx you by any means. I know every time you say that to an actor, they're like, Fana! I work so, and I know you've been working years for this, mm-hmm, but
absolutely.
Have you hit that point where you're like, okay, I'm doing this, and I'm a working actor. Has that safety feeling come in yet, or no?
I don't know if I'd ever really call an actor's journey safe, per se, but it does feel more safe and mm-hmm. definitely more secure than prior years, for sure. So it's nice because I think it's so important, for instance, to have a team of support around you, and I have an incredible team. And I think it's made it easier for all of us to kind of collaborate and keep the momentum going, and mm-hmm. I think that's what's important, is like, all right, cool, so I'm doing this, and not to like rest. I still sleep, but to keep pushing, because mm-hmm. like I feel like the moment I let my foot off the gas pedal, then, you know,
somebody else will jump.
Absolutely.
Dive in. Mm-hmm. Speaking of kind of all the things, you have surrounded yourself with an amazing team. You said you've made mistakes, you've learned a lot.
Yes, I have.
And I know I mentioned that Jona is an actor that helps actors. Your company, Career mm-hmm. Activate.
Correct.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about it? I've been lucky enough to be taught by you and to go to some of your I guess lectures and kind of workshops. Mm-hmm. But tell everybody else about it, because it's really awesome.
Sure. So just a couple weeks ago, I gave a talk at SAG, which was really cool. Yeah.
That's so exciting.
Yeah,
Congrats.
It was really fun. Yeah, it was awesome. And so Career Activate basically helps actors master the business side of the industry. And so it's a group of working actors that are helping actors who are not yet working consistently, and also actors that are working and want to get to that next level. So we talk about branding, networking, getting the right team, like we talked mm-hmm. about with reps, and just having the business side down, because that's what I lacked for a long time in the early years of my career, where I'm like, I've taken all these acting classes, like, why can't I get an audition? Speaking of mistakes, one of the first agents I ever got out here, and I'm really grateful to, again, have the team that I do now, my first agent ever out here, I was like, someone wants to sign me, then yes, obviously I work with them, because, you know, it's desperate.
Yeah. Please take me, I'm yours.
And this particular agent, I think he had his heyday, like, maybe in the 80s or, mm-hmm. like, prior, and I think that his reputation was not as strong as it used to be.
Yeah.
And when I was in his office for the first meeting, we talked for an hour, and his phone only rang one time, and he didn't have a secretary or any assistance or help at his agency. And at the time, I was like, yeah, maybe that's a red flag, but that's okay.
Yeah.
And then he also told me he didn't believe in email.
Oh!
Yeah, but I was like, he wants to work with me, let's do it. So it didn't really last very long. He was a sweet, sweet guy, just wasn't a fit for me.
Yeah.
So,
well, you learn.
Yes.
You move on.
That's exactly what I was going to say. Yeah.
Has there been a moment yet, or like, did you have a moment like in your career, especially in the last couple of years, that you were a little like, oh my gosh, I'm here, I'm doing what I love and what I've worked for. Have you had a pinch me moment? I'm sure you've had a few, but
yeah, I've been so lucky and grateful to work with amazing like directors and cast and crew. I remember when I was working on Keeping Up with the Joneses, which was my first ever studio feature film. So I primarily did television and then indie film, but I never done a studio feature before until Keeping Up with the Joneses. And I remember being in the waiting room area, the green room, and I looked up and there was Gal Gadot, Zach Galifianakis, Isla Fisher, John Hamm, and I was like, oh my gosh. And I had that moment. I'm like, oh wow, these actors that I've respected for so many years. And I remember like having to like tell myself, I'm like, remember, Jona, you belong here. Like, you are amongst this cast. You belong in this green room.
Oh, my God.
Because I was, like, feeling,
That's
like, a little nervous
awesome.
At first. So, yeah, that was definitely, like, a moment for me.
What was it like working with, how do you, when you're on set and you're mm-hmm. about to do a line or a scene with somebody mm-hmm. like that, how do you kind of get your mindset out of the starstruckness into the, okay, focus? Like, because
sure.
you've worked with a lot of big people.
I've worked with, yeah, like some amazing actors and some, you know, that I had a little crushes on. But
I mean, John Hamm.
So if I do ogle, I try to make sure they're not looking at me while I'm ogling. So that's step one. And another thing is to, as much as possible in terms of mindset, is to see them as a peer mm-hmm. and instead of someone that's like on this like pedestal.
Yeah.
So just saying that, like, we're all working, you know, from the camera operator to the director to the actors, everyone together is collaborating on this project. So they're a peer, that's all.
We're just doing our jobs mm-hmm. together. How has your family and friends reacted to you? I feel like every time I turn the TV on, like, there was a while when your Super Bowl commercial was running that I saw you on a daily basis on my TV.
My one of my friends, Royale, I had no idea that the GE commercial yeah. was gonna start airing. Such a big moment. And then I got all these texts, and I was so blown away by all the support. And my friend Royale, he texts me a screenshot, and he goes, "Is this you, or am I being racist?" I'm like, it is me. It doesn't mean you're not racist, but it is me. So yeah, I've been really lucky to just get awesome support. And my parents, they're cute. They're like, oh yeah, let us know when we can watch things. And I remember another moment that, this was a few years back, I would say, when I started booking like television. Mm-hmm. And me and my dad, we always had kind of a very, we didn't really get along very much like growing up. There was mm-hmm. a lot of like yelling matches and a lot of like him feeling he knows what's best for me and me disagreeing. and I remember like just so much of my life, I just wanted to make him proud. Like mm-hmm. that was something that was very important to me. And he started texting and I started to actually update him on what was going on with my life and career, something that I didn't normally do. Mm-hmm. And then he sent me back this text that said, Jona, I've always known you're very smart and you'd be successful at whatever you put your mind to. I'm so proud of you. And honestly, that text message is probably like, I just started like tearing up and I was like, oh my gosh, like finally. I mean, not that I don't think I should need my parents' validation, but it was nice to have.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, nice. And I feel like anyone that goes into the arts, it's a big risk mm-hmm. going into this industry, and a lot of people who are not in it don't get it.
Absolutely.
And it's very hard to understand unless you are in it. I remember I dragged my mom to La La Land, and I was like, this kind of shows you what I deal with. I don't have a Ryan Gosling, and I don't bust out into song, unfortunately. Only when I'm in my car. This is kind of what my life is like, but other than that, yeah, they don't really get it. But
it's very different, and my parents come from a very like practical mm-hmm. background, and I know they do it out of love, you know.
Yeah,
they're tough love.
Well, let's talk about your new movie Gifted.
Yes.
That which is coming out April 12th. Mm-hmm. Now this movie, the cast is phenomenal, and
yes.
I remember when, I can't remember when I saw the first like teaser trailer for this, I was like, I want to see this movie. I had no idea you were attached to the film, and I'm now even more excited to see the film because you're in it. Tell me a little bit about the film and about your role.
Sure, so what I can say about the film and my role is that it's about this brilliant young girl, Mary Adler, played by McKenna Grace. And so she's this young girl who has incredible mathematical abilities.
Yeah.
And so it's this drama that basically deals with the question, how do you raise someone who's so gifted, hence the mm-hmm. name of the film? And you know, her uncle's essentially raising her because her mom passed away. So that's mm-hmm. played by Chris Evans. And so he's of the opinion that she should live a very normal life, and he doesn't want her like stigmatized or, you know, having people like having her grow up in this like weird environment where she doesn't get to live a normal life. Mm-hmm. And then there's her grandma who thinks on the opposite end of
yeah.
the scale. It's like, no, like she should get like publicity and she should have the attention she deserves. And so, yeah, I think it'll strike an interesting conversation after the film of like raising children and parenthood. And
that was another question I was going to ask you. What do you think kind of audiences will take away from this film? It's a very moving trailer.
Yes.
And I feel like if you're not touched by the trailer, then you might have a problem. But so I can't even imagine what the film in its entirety is like. So what do you hope people kind of take away from it?
Sure. So for me, I think that empathy is one of the most important qualities we can have as human beings. And I think it's so easy to be able to just judge something and say, this is not me, this is me.
Mm-hmm.
Or this person does something that I don't agree with, and thus they're evil or they're terrible. And I hope when people watch this film, it's like, yes, in many ways we're on Chris Evans' side, but at the same time, like,
it's Captain America. It's Civil War.
Exactly. And at the same time, it's like Mary Adler's grandma, she there's a very strong perspective she brings too, and I think it's important to be able to be empathetic and really fully understand people's motivations and why they do the things that they do instead of demonizing people.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that will really help with what's happening in the world right now.
Preach, preach. So what role do you play?
Sure.
How much can you tell us?
So I play a character named Li Juan, and so through my character, I help the audience realize just how smart Mary Adler really,
ooh,
truly is.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, so I question certain things, and yeah.
I'd be curious to see what side you're on, if you're the one who kind of unlocks like the true genius within this little girl. What was it like? I mean, this little girl's phenomenal on
mm-hmm.
screen. What? How old was she when you guys filmed this? And like, feel like she's an actor prodigy in her own right. Like, really?
She. I swear she's like a 25-year-old in a little kid's body. I think when we were filming, I think she was 10 or 11, I believe. But she was just like a joy to work with. Some people say like never work with kids or pets. Mm-hmm. She did not act like, I guess, what people normally associate with a child actor.
Yeah.
Like, she was humble. She was sweet. She was like, she wasn't too rambunctious. She was very precocious. And yeah, I was just like in awe of her. I was like, wow, like had I...
And then what was it like working with Captain America himself?
I definitely had like I remember the first time I saw him on set. We were filming in a university in Atlanta, and I was like, oh my gosh, he's more attractive in person than on screen. And I didn't think that was possible. I didn't think it was, but it was. And I was like, oh, he plays an awesome dad. And just like a perfect gentleman. Like, I have nothing bad to say about him.
Well, you got to work with one of my favorite actresses, Octavia Spencer.
I didn't get to actually film with
you
her.
You didn't get to film? Oh! Have you met her?
I have not.
She is one of the sweetest, most humble people.
I believe that. So good to hear.
I was lucky enough to meet her on the red carpet once, and she... like, the energy from that woman is amazing. I look forward to when I get to talk to you next. After you've done all the press for this and you've met her. So.
Yeah, the premiere's tomorrow, so I might meet her tomorrow.
Oh my god! I'm so glad I was able to get you in tonight, Ben. You're busy. So let's see. We can watch that when April 12th is when it comes out. Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there anything else you want to kind of tell us about Gifted before we move on to all the other amazing things you do?
Maybe bring some tissues.
Oh no! Is it gonna make me cry? I mean, maybe the trailer makes me cry.
The trailer makes me cry.
Well, great. So check out Gifted on April 12th.
Mm-hmm.
And what studio did Gifted or what?
Fox.
Fox.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. So most recently, we've seen you on a lot of TV. besides Keeping Up with the Joneses, we've seen you on Being Mary Jane,
mm-hmm.
as well as Halt and Catch Fire.
Yes.
Now, neither of these shows are shows that I watch.
That's okay.
But I'm there's so many people that do watch these shows, because if there's any shows that I hear about a lot, it's these two shows. Is your role on Halt and Catch Fire completely done, or is there a chance that you can come back?
I believe it's done, but there's always, you never know.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the season, they basically fast forward to the future, so... Mm. Maybe if it's a flashback, or maybe if they like age my character a little bit and bring her back, which would be awesome.
Bring Julie Yang back.
She was a really fun character. She's a ball buster. My wardrobe was inspired, the idea was Asian chola.
And you're kind of this like badass like chick like computer programmer in the 80s. Like,
yeah, it was.
What?
I
so much fun.
I had so much fun, like, just because I'm the only female coder in that group, essentially. And it's like all these guys that are like silly and ridiculous, and you know, we all give each other a lot of shit. But like, anytime if I feel like someone's being sexist or someone's attacking me, like, I just throw out the most like random insults. Like, I'll be like, F you, semen. And then, like, the other character be like, did you just call me semen? And I'm like, yes, I did.
See, now all my roommates watch Halt and Catch Fire. I'm going to have to go back and watch it now. They're like, I know her.
It's hard to recognize me because I look like a little Asian boy.
Really? Mm-hmm. Did they put a wig on you, or?
Oh no, I just have a cap, but like it looks like I've, you know, and they cut my hair and everything too. Where there was an alternate take. It was, unfortunately, they didn't end up going with that one, but there's like a brawl that breaks out in the office, and I just like rip off my shirt, and I'm like in very baggy clothes.
Yeah.
And I'm wearing like a very feminine like bra, this leopard print bra, and then one of the guys is like, that's a girl. So that was one of the alternate takes that we shot.
That's awesome. That's so much fun. Oh my god, I'm gonna have to watch Halt and Catch Fire because I just want to see you like step back into the 80s Asian Chola. So in Being Mary Jane, you play Natalie Wu.
Yes.
And you're still currently on the season.
The last episode of the first half of season 4.
Okay.
Finished.
Mm-hmm. So you're done with that. Are you coming back to being Mary Jane? Can you talk about this?
I believe there were certain negotiations. Okay. And I don't know the final result. Okay.
Fingers crossed. Let's keep Jona employed. Well, that's awesome. Is there any other TV that you've been auditioning for that you would like kill to have a role on?
Oh man, there's just so much good TV. Like I love Fresh Off the Boat. I think hilarious. Yes. Have you seen it yet?
I have. I don't watch it regularly, but it's one of those shows that if it's on, I'll put it on just because I laugh all the time. But then this is the thing about like Fresh Off the Boat and Blackish. I think are two of the best shows on comedies on television right now. But I feel somewhat guilty. Like it's a weird thing for me because I feel like I'm watching this and there's like a lot of I don't know. They just bring up a lot of stereotypes.
I was gonna say, is it because you're white?
Yes, because I'm white. I feel bad, but I think they're so well done. But then yeah, I feel guilty laughing at some of the things because I'm white. I said it.
No, I think they want you to laugh.
They want me to laugh.
I think that's totally fine.
Jona told me it's okay to laugh. Yes. Well, speaking of kind of like these, just kind of seeing different races within the television world and the lack of, I think, of representation, but it's kind of being fixed a little bit. What has kind of been your experience as an Asian woman auditioning for roles and kind of seeing... like a little bit of whitewashing, I feel like, when it comes to, there's the recent thing with Scarlett Johansson and Ghost in the Shell, which is out. What's kind of your opinion on all of that?
Sure. So I think traditionally it's been very, very rough, especially with Asian Americans. I remember as of a few years ago, I think the statistic was the percentage of Asians on television represented in the media and TV and film was, I think, half the percentage of Asians that are living in the U.S. And so it was like it was in half. And so that was tough. And I think that Hollywood had a tough time trusting Asians, especially in leading roles. And I would say the last maybe year, I think it has gotten a lot better. Mm-hmm. For me, I have seen a lot more opportunities, which is great. And I love being able to see more and more Asian actors playing awesome three-dimensional roles in TV and film. Mm-hmm. So I think it's getting better. Is it where I'd like it to be? Not quite.
Yeah.
But I think what I really appreciate is the progress and the momentum that is there that I'm personally seeing.
And that's awesome that you're seeing that as a young girl who's always dreamed about diving into this industry where when you were younger, I'm sure like the representation of like kind of cool Asian like young girls on television and in movies, like
it wasn't much.
There wasn't any.
No, I remember I had one argument I had with my growing up, right, when I first told him I want to be an actor, and he was like, oh, this is just like a thing, it'll go away, you know. I remember we were in this argument and he was like, Jona, if you were white, maybe I would support this, but there's like no Asians in TV and film. I was like, there's Lucy Liu. And he's like, okay, one.
God bless you, Lucy Liu.
Right? And she paved, yes, God bless Lucy Liu indeed. I mean, she paved the way in many ways for Asian actors after her. And there's, you know, there's been a few across history that are well known, but not that many. And so that was literally a conversation, a fight that my dad and I had back in the day when you rarely saw, I think, that's an Asian woman.
That's really insightful. Thank you for sharing that,
because
that's kind of an interesting thing as like a young woman, because obviously like, when I was watching TV and wanting to be an actress, like there's so many girls that look like me, and then I get here and I'm like, there's a lot of girls that look like me. There's too many of me. I'm never gonna do this. But I do consider myself lucky, like being able to look up to that. But God bless Lucy Liu.
Yes.
God bless Lucy Liu. So I can't move on from like all the things you've done until we talk about Spider-Man Homecoming.
Now, I felt that coming.
This movie has been so hyped. They just recently released a new trailer. It was awesome. I really, really love the direction that they're going with this film. I saw you in the first trailer. I did not see you in the second one unless I just missed you. Are you in the most recent one?
It would be tough to see me. I think I'm technically in it, but it would be very difficult.
Are you on the barge when he's like, I don't know. I was like, look at, I like watched it a couple times.
It would be hard to find me, okay. But I think I technically am in there. I've been in a few of the trailers, but not all of them. Mm-hmm. So what was your question?
You can't tell me a lot. What can you tell me? And then I'll probably ask you a question or a couple follow-up questions, and you might be like, sure. I can't tell you that.
I am very confident it's going to be an incredible film that everyone should go see. And I believe I can share, one of the actors I was very fortunate to work with was actually Marissa Tomei. So I got to work with her, and man, ever since I watched My Cousin Vinny, like, she's been one of my like favorite actors of all time. And she is one of the most like humble, down to earth people. Like, I remember between some takes, like she was like, that was so good. I was like, this is so flattering. I found out later that she actually helped cast me in my role.
How did she do that? Can you?
She didn't give me any details, but she helped with the decision making process, and I was not aware.
Did you do a chemistry read with her or with anybody?
I don't think I can talk about the actual audition process because I did sign an NDA. Yes,
NDAs always go back to I signed an NDA. I can't say anything, right? But I believe it. Believe me, I believe it. Let me see. Any other questions? Is your character from the comic book world, or is it new for the movie? Oh, she pleads the fifth, guys. She pleads the fifth.
My friends are so... Speaking of how friends react, I remember hanging out at the bar with some friends of mine, and one of them was just so persistent, and he was like, well, Jona, I won't tell anyone, but, like, what's your character? And I'm like, I can't say anything. He's like, but I won't tell anyone. I'm like, but the whole point is I can't tell anyone. Like, it's not about whether you'll tell someone. It's I can't tell anyone. And then he was like, all right, so I'm going to say some character names. And if that's you, just blink. And he went on for a while. And he
that's
knew a
big
lot about
universe.
The comics.
It's a really big universe. Have you read the comics?
I've read a little bit of it, but I have not.
You haven't dealt. Well, Spider-Man has been going on for forever.
Yes.
But,
mm-hmm. And this is the first Spider-Man that Marvel's actually created for the first time.
Yes.
Which some people don't know that, I think.
Yeah, because Sony still owns the rights, but I think they leased it out to Marvel so they could include, because Spider-Man is a part of Shield. What is it?
Agents of Shield.
Agents of Shield. Mm-hmm. Spider-Man is technically, is it the Justice League? No, that's...
Batman and...
That's Batman and them.
The Avengers.
Thank you! Spider-Man is a part of... My co-host for Disney Movie News would kill me. he is technically a part of that. So he was in Civil War, which mm-hmm. was...
As part of the Avengers, yeah.
He was one of my favorite parts of Civil War.
Tom Holland's Spider-Man is, like, sarcastic and, you know, it's cool to follow... this young Spider-Man who's just now getting his powers and he's in high school. So it's a much younger Spider-Man than we're used to.
And I feel like it's a younger take on it too, because Tobey Maguire was supposed to be this younger Spider-Man that I feel like played the high school Spider-Man when he was almost 30 years old.
Different energy, for sure.
Very different energy. Mm-hmm. And I have not seen the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man, so I don't even know what to base. I'm going to watch them before Homecoming comes out just because I want to compare and contrast. Did you, what was it like working with my namesake, Michael Keaton? Did you get to work with him?
I don't think I can say anything else about it.
Okay.
I really appreciate your persistence. It's very, that was good. I like how you stuck that in there.
I mean, he reprises his role as Birdman in this film. So it's pretty, I love Michael Keaton. He's like one of those actors that like every time I do a red carpet or I'm at an event, like, I'm like, oh my God, Michael Keaton's here. I gotta find a way to meet him.
Like, all sorts of stars and met all sorts of people.
I have been very, very lucky where the carpets and the places I've been able to go and talk to people that I admire, such as yourself. And but Michael Keaton has evaded me.
Oh.
But one of these days.
Michael Keaton. You gotta meet Keetin Marchi.
Yes, Michael. Keaton photo, I feel like. I want to be in a picture at some point in my life with Michael Keaton, Diane Keaton, and Keetin Marchi. I just think it would be a really cool group. Too bad Buster Keaton has passed on, but it would be great. So,
in the meantime, you know, there's Photoshop.
There. I love it. I love it. Jonah's the type of person where, you know, you tell her, oh, I don't think you can do it. She's like, watch me. Like, literally, like, that is, like, your personality to a T.
I think that's pretty accurate. I think there's a lot that motivate. I just think about, like, growing up. And there was, I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri, primarily. Mm-hmm. And there weren't many Asians. And so there were a lot of racist stereotypes that were very frequent. And I just remember, like, trying to do so many things like sports, and this is how I got into playing poker as a teenager, was because someone was like, well, girls can't do that, or like, well, that's not like an Asian thing to do, and I'm like, screw that. Like, I'll prove you wrong. And
Jonah comes in and takes all your money.
And I think that that's what's actually the plus side of adversity is, especially when people don't believe in you and don't think that you can do the things that you can, because I think anyone can do anything that anyone else can do. And I think that was like a big fuel for me, and actually helped me, like, looking back. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like sometimes I don't. My friends in my life right now, I'm like, you guys are being too supportive. Like, can someone just be like, you can't do this? And I'll be like, I'll prove you wrong. It's so weird.
It's like, Jonah's like, I've lost all my life. Like, nobody's
ripping me down.
Don't hate on Jonah, guys.
Oh, did I just welcome internet trolls?
No trolls. Don't hate on Jonah.
Don't
kindness.
Bully people in general.
Don't bully. Yeah, lift people up, because it's only going to lift you up. Mm-hmm. So now that, so being a part of Marvel, mm-hmm. you're kind of under the Disney umbrella a little bit. Mm-hmm. There's a new live-action Mulan that's currently casting.
Yes.
And I think you would be a phenomenal Mulan.
Thank you. I agree.
I was going to have you
That's
auditioned?
One of my dream roles.
Okay. Yeah. Have you yet to audition? Are you in the process of auditioning?
I have auditioned. And then I think the last thing I heard was they were looking in mainland China for someone that's in China now.
But you were born in China.
Yes, I was.
She's not fresh off the boat, but
some years since. But yeah, I was born in China. And yeah, that's when you mentioned like dream roles, and mm-hmm. for a drama, like, I saw myself playing Mulan. And there's actually another live action Mulan film, I think that Sony?
Like
they're doing
Disney's
another one,
like,
too.
I'm going to do a Little Mermaid, and, like, Sony or Fox or somebody's like, well, I'm going to do a Little Mermaid.
So one of these two. I would just be very honored to get to play a character that inspired me so much growing up. Like, we talked about the lack of Asian representation, especially years and years ago. And Mulan, even though, you know, she was a cartoon at that time, like, she was, like, so inspiring to me. And I'm like, she's so cool. Like, I want to be just like her. And it's a weird analogy, but just go with me. I play for fun, flag football. It's like my go-to way of staying active.
You're on Instagram, right? And you've posted flag. You guys have to follow her on Instagram, because her flag football outfit is the... She's like the ninja of flag football. Like,
my nickname is Sub-Zero from Mortal Kombat. I have a blue mask. You cannot recognize me. Yes, that is my daytime attire when I play football. And I'm one of the few female quarterbacks in the area that quarterbacks in co-ed leagues. And so I definitely dealt with a good amount of, I feel like, sexism mm-hmm. In terms of being a female quarterback, and just, you know, the shit people would say, or like how they would try to get it underneath my skin, and having to lead a group of men, like, kind of in a way, like Mulan, not into
Let's
battle,
get
but
down
like
to business
to defeat the Huns. But in many ways, like, earning the trust of these guys who played in college and high school, and
be
trusting
a man, you must be sweet.
Oh my gosh, I'm on a karaoke night with like Mulan songs. Yeah.
We'll do the whole soundtrack.
Right? And just, yeah, having to like earn their trust. And I've been really grateful for, there's been both sides. There's been people that are like the naysayers. And there's also been a lot of like both women and men that have been like so supportive and like helpful and coaching me and cheering me on through the good times and the bad. So yeah, there's some parallels.
I could so... It's so funny. I watched Mulan like two nights ago
because
I know that's why like that's really. But when I run like long distances, mm-hmm. because I have Disney movies just memorized in my head because I've watched them so many times, I just go through Disney movies because I know all the lines and then I'll sing the songs in my head, and before I know it, I'm 15 minutes through the movie and I'm done running, and I've run like 2 miles. I'm like, what?
That's awesome.
I didn't even notice I was running. But Mulan was one of my favorite movies growing up, mm-hmm. and whenever I clean, I watch Disney movies. Because I know them so well. So Mulan was a couple nights ago when I was cleaning.
Oh.
And I think I watched Mulan and Pocahontas because I had a lot of cleaning to do. And Disney movies are not that long. But I literally was sitting there, I was like, oh my God, Jona would be the I can't think of a better like Chinese, like American actress who's the right age, who is actually Chinese, because she's from a Chinese fable. And mm-hmm. It really irks me when they cast Asian roles as just, I mean, I don't know if this irks you, but like, if the role is of a, you know, half Chinese, half, you know, white person, don't cast a half Japanese. I don't know. That's just kind of how I feel. Or if it's a Chinese girl, please cast a Chinese girl. Like, don't cast a Japanese or a Vietnamese or, you know, any other Asian, because they all are such distinct cultures. And I just feel like if we need to represent them correctly and not just kind of kitty corner all of Asians.
Right. I would agree with you for Mulan. I definitely would. I remember this was a long time ago. I was auditioning and it was one of those auditions that said, you know, Asian, and this was like for a print job. Mm-hmm. And so it was just like mainly photos, that kind of thing. And so all over the casting notice and also in the waiting room area, like on the walls where all these signs that are like, we are looking for only Chinese actress, must like actor slash model must be Chinese, casting director is Chinese, we'll know if you're not Chinese. I'm like, oh, okay, I get it. Like,
yeah.
And I get it because some people lie about their ethnicity. I've never. But
I can't.
Chinese? No?
No. Yes.
Scarlett Johansson. Right.
I have a story for you when we're off camera that I have to tell you about that.
So I walk in, I meet the casting director, and so she looks up at me and she's like, you're not Chinese. And I've never been told that ever in my whole life before, like that I'm not, you know. And so it takes me back and I'm just like, and I gestured to my resume. I'm like, actually, I was born in China. I speak Mandarin. And she just like glared at me. She was just like glaring at me. And I was just like, surprise, I did not book the role. I did not book the job.
Hate is gonna hate.
But I was like, wow, that is so interesting. Like, I don't know what it about me. She was just like, not Chinese.
You know, I've heard of casting directors doing a lot of crazy things, but like taking away your race and your heritage.
Well, I think maybe because she was, like, I'm Chinese, but I do not think that I definitively would be able to tell you this person is not.
Yeah.
I don't think I could.
Yeah. I couldn't either. I try not to be racist such as your friend. Like I just am like, no, I plead the fifth. Like, please, where are you from? Please tell me. Educate me, please, because I'd rather be educated than ignorant.
I love that.
So this is what I love to do at the end of any of my interviews mm-hmm. with actors. And we kind of did put the Mulan thing out in the universe. But you have to put things out in the universe, I feel like, to have it come back around.
Agreed.
Or even if it's going around you for it to maybe catch hold. Mm-hmm. So we're going to go through a few things and put them out in the universe. Dream role, Mulan, obviously for dramatic, but I also think that it better be funny too, because I love this movie, it's hilarious. But television role.
I would love to play like an Asian Lucille Ball, like in like an I Love Lucy, because I just naturally I'm a bit awkward, but it's something that my friends call awkward confidence. Very confident, but weird stuff flies out of my mouth. And also, I love physical comedy. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the reasons I think that helped me book Julie Yang for Halt and Catch Fire, because I added like some physical things that weren't necessarily scripted mm-hmm. in, when I was auditioning and during the callback process. And so I got like, being able to do that and combining that with like the comedy work, that would be like an amazing dream, like comedy role.
I think you'd be great in something like that. That would be, I would watch it.
Thanks.
Dream actor or actress, dream actor and dream actress to work with?
Edward Norton.
Oh, good one.
He's incredible. And actress, oh man, so many to pick from. I'll go with Sally Fields.
That's a good one. Mm-hmm. I was not expecting that. I really like that. She's great. Mm-hmm. Dream director to work with?
I got to work with one of my dream directors for Forgifted, Mark Webb.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Because, fun fact, so he had, you know, a lot of people know he directed 500 Days of Summer, which is one of my all-time favorite films.
Such a good film, yeah.
Yes. And that film helped me emotionally get over my cheating boyfriend at the time.
So, who would cheat on Jona? She'd kick your butt.
I appreciate that.
That fool is probably like, he's not with us anymore.
So, yeah. So Mark has been a dream director to work with. Who else? Let's see. Oh, man. I'll just say, I've worked with Mark Webb.
Mark Wood.
Yeah.
Well, you've checked that one off the list then. Dream TV show to actually be in?
Game of Thrones.
Yes, I was hoping you were going to say that. Yes. We only got 2 seasons left, girl. You got to get in there.
They're starting to include a few more Asians.
Yeah, and they might cover you in like tree bark, but you'll be a little
fine.
Children
totally cool
of the forest. But you're like, I'm in. I'd do it. Make me a child of the forest. I'm in. Dream on-screen kiss.
Penn Badgley. He was in Gossip Girl.
You were a Gossip Girl fan. Yeah. Okay, I know who Penn Badgley is.
And I actually had a little crush on him even before Gossip Girl. I forgot the name of the show that he was starring in before Gossip Girl, like when he was younger. Mm. And I just remember, I was like, he's so charming and sweet. I'll say Penn Badgley.
Have you seen him recently?
No.
He's I remember he popped up on one of those Facebook things, like, what do they look like now? And obviously, Blake Lively looks exactly the same.
Of course.
She just now has babies and she's glowing and she's married to Ryan Reynolds. And if you're not glowing after being married to Ryan Reynolds, there's a problem with you. He's super hipster now. I don't know if he has a beard or what. I mean, he's still very charming. Yeah, but he's very different than the clean-cut boy we all fell in love with on Gossip Girl.
Oh, I see.
But he's Gossip Girl himself. So. Dream. Let me see. I want to do one more. If you could play any superhero, because there's so many superhero movies, or dream kind of fandom to be in. You know, there's obviously Harry Potter, there's Star Wars, there's the Disney princesses. We know Mulan is going to be one of them. Like, there's the Marvel.
So Mulan. Right?
Other than Mulan.
Okay, outside
because
of Mulan.
Because Mulan is happening, guys. Someday I'll be on Disney Movie News being like, remember that time I had Mulan in studio, just me and Mulan? Great. Remember that time me and Mulan had a game night together?
Let's see. Ooh, that's a good question. I loved the Harry Potter books growing up. Love Lord of the Rings. Oh, so many good ones. I'll say Harry Potter, that world. If they continue that world.
Yeah, I mean, with Fantastic Beasts, I feel like they are definitely trying to continue that world, and it'll be fun.
Magic.
I know. I mean, J.K. Rowling was the one who got me, created my love of reading. So anything now that she puts out, any article, I read it just because I think that Harry Potter world that she created made me fall in love, I think, with make-believe and fantasy and want to become an actor and be able to make-believe. Because I saw those kids do it, like Daniel Radcliffe, Emma Watson, and I was like, oh my gosh, they're the same age as me. I feel like I grew up with them. So,
yes.
If they did it, I can do it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I one of my early on, before age 12, I wanted to be, me and my family watched Belinda, the First Lady of Magic. So she did this magic show. And I didn't know basically, I thought everything was real. And so I, in the car, on the way back, I was like, Dad, I want to be like the second lady of magic. And he was like, really? I'm like, mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to be a magician. Like, I want to like have powers and I want to like be a magician and help people. And I said, Dad, I can even help you with your stocks. I would make your stocks go up. Now, my dad was really into like stock market stuff at the time.
Now you see me three, maybe. Maybe we'll see it.
Those are really fun films.
Maybe,
as well.
Maybe. So I know we're running out of time. So what's coming next for you that you can talk about? Any of your own projects that you're working on, besides Spider-Man: Homecoming and Gifted?
I would say there's some like potential projects in the works, but nothing I can talk about right now.
Oh. So, where can we follow you then to find out what those projects are when you can talk about them?
Sure. So you can follow me at JonaXiao. So that's just Jona Xiao, and that's for Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Did I miss one? No.
You have a pretty awesome website too. Do you? I don't know if you use that a ton, but
not usually. No, not usually. Not usually the best
keep
way to
get stick
touch
it to
with
the
me.
Social media, guys. Well, thank you so much,
thank
Jona.
You,
this has been so much fun to be able to talk with you about
I'm
all this
so
stuff.
I'm so excited that it was you that was interviewing me.
Like every single time now, if I see like that you're coming in, I'm like, I want her. Well, just, this will be a continuation series.
Sounds
as we
good.
As we lead up to the role as Mulan. You have to promise me that if and when you do get Mulan, you come back in and when you're doing promotion.
Only if it's Keetin.
Okay, great. You heard that, producer out there. Well, thank you again. I hope
thank
to see you back soon. And good luck and congratulations.
Thank
it's
you.
So great to see you succeeding as much as you are.
Thank you so much.
You're so deserving of it all. So
thank you.
You guys make sure you follow Jona. And you can follow me everywhere at Keetin Marchi on across the board, just like Jona. And make sure to follow us all here at the Popcorn Talk Network. See you guys next time. Thanks for watching.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.